person, mm-hmm. but you didn't name the person.
No, and it's interesting because there are several names that I changed to protect people's identities and prefer to keep it that way, but it'll be interesting for people who read to see if they would know who it might be. And there was actually a gentleman that my parents met on a ship that was docked in the harbor in outside of Morocco when they were stuck there for several months and couldn't get across the ocean past the French fleet. And this gentleman that they met actually saved my parents' life because all the other people on the ship had to disembark and go to a holding camp, a concentration camp in Casablanca. And this gentleman, because he was from a Belgian ship, befriended my parents because my mother was Belgian. And there's a great story that goes along with that. And I actually was able to get a copy to him before he passed away as well.
Oh, that's nice. The when you talked about the French fleet being in the way, was that a Vichy France?
Yes.
Yeah.
And interestingly, the story that it was really impactful there was that my father had been carrying, he had managed to secure and keep his Leica camera, which was his most prized possession. And he was a photographer, and he took pictures of the fleet and then gave them to the British when they landed on this side of the ocean, and feels that he made a contribution, perhaps, to the winning of the war.
Probably did, yes. And when they came here, they had relatives here already.
Yes, my father had some relatives that were already here, and my father's father, my grandfather, fortunately had been able to maintain some of his money and was able to send some money to my parents and get it to them to help them to get over. But there were so many things that got in the way, so many blocks to their progress. There were times when they got a ticket to take a ship over, and they were unable to embark because they couldn't get into Spain, because my father was of a German background, and there was an agreement with the Spanish that they wouldn't allow German young men to come through. So here they had tickets on a boat, could have gotten over, and weren't able to. Mm. So they had to find another way, always another way.
Do you, I'm just thinking about what your parents might have had in mind, other than telling you the story, mm-hmm. which is fascinating in and of itself. But was there something, some other message that they wanted to get across to their children and grandchildren that they chose this vehicle?
I think maybe they weren't thinking about it at the time. I think at the time it was just that they wanted to share their background with us. But I think what it became is something that some people refer to as an ethical will. And that is the sharing of one's personal values that are not material values, but personal values that one has learned over a lifetime or as long as one has been alive. And interestingly, I learned that I prefer to call them legacy letters because it's confusing to call it ethical will.
Yes.
Some people confuse it with something that's legal, which it is not, and not that a will and testament isn't ethical. So
right.
A legacy letter is basically just sharing what one has learned, and I've found, and what's of value. I found that that's an interesting exercise to do at various times throughout one's life. And I've encouraged my husband, who's going to be celebrating a milestone year this year, and we videotaped him talking about his life and what he's learned and what he wants to share. But we've also done the same thing with my 17-year-old stepdaughter. Because I feel it's really a good idea for her to capture
you had her write
a legacy letter, and actually I recorded it digitally as well, because I feel that at age 17 there are some things that one has values and feels are important that might change, probably will change, when she graduates from high school, when she gets married, when she has children of her own, and it would be good to document those things and see how the legacy changes.
That is fascinating. Although the feeling I have from your dad and your mom is that even beyond the story, the life that they lived conveyed a lot of their values
Absolutely.
To you already.
That's true.
So what you got really was an articulation of something that you probably already knew a lot.
Many of the values they demonstrated we knew. But the stories, obviously, we did not. And so I feel that we sort of completed our relationship with them in a way.
Yes.
And that was very satisfying. And now that my father's gone and my mother's suffering from dementia, I'm so grateful that we did it when we did it.
Absolutely. And it also helped you to understand, did it, where those values came from.
Yes.
What were the experiences that might have been, so that maybe some things that were puzzling to you at one point, you gave an example mm-hmm. when you said he was very reserved.
That's right.
He didn't smile right away.
That's right.
So maybe that kind of thing makes you feel better. I mean, he wasn't singling you out.
No, this was, it's true. And I know that our generation tends to talk and share more than their generation did. And I'm really encouraging that others will share these stories with their families so that they will have the benefit of learning from generations that preceded them and be able to carry it on to generations that come after.
Are there websites that help people do oral histories?
Yes, and the Association of Personal Historians has a fabulous website, personalhistorians.org.
Oh, it's right up on the screen now.
Good.
Yes.
And there are many very talented people in that organization that can help people tell their stories in whatever mechanism that is comfortable for them. It doesn't have to be in a written book. It can be orally, it can be a video, it can be a photo montage. There are lots of ways to do that.
A photo montage where you would translate your photos onto a DVD and tell a story while it's going on?
Yes, and actually there are some folks that I know who do it in a family tree that they call the living tree, that you can go to a website and see the individuals in the family tree and they come to life with videos and constantly updated. So yeah, there are lots of wonderful ways to capture family stories.
And your children now, you have the stepdaughter?
Yes.
They of course have read the
yes
the story, mm-hmm. and they're probably thinking about what they want to find out from you, right? And your brother and your sister.
To be interesting, yes.
And what story you might.
all have them.
yeah, because your story will be just as fascinating to them as your parents.
Hopefully. I don't know whether it'll be as dramatic, perhaps, as my parents' story was, because truly it was a drama that we never realized existed, and I'm so glad that the story was told.
Oh, I am too. Is there anything else that you want to add that we didn't get a chance to talk about?
Well, I just would like to say that I'm so grateful that when I was at my father's bedside when he was passing, that I shared something so intimate with him that I could have missed. And I'd also like to say that the story that they told, both my parents told, has so much intrigue and betrayal and romance that it's as if they lived a life in a movie, and that this could very well be a movie. And if you listen, that others will find that there are stories like that in their families as well.
Yes, and hearing it at their 50th wedding anniversary, it might have been a little hard to think of them as being romantic. And
that's for sure.
And all of a sudden you realize they had this whole life before you came into the picture.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank you so much. This was fascinating.
Thank you, Rebecca.
I'm glad I read the book. Bring it back to the library so that others can enjoy it as well.